Hey everybody, welcome back to Reimagining the Internet. I'm your host, Ethan Zuckerman, at the Institute for Digital Public Infrastructure at the University of Massachusetts at Amherst. I am here with my friend Geert Jan Bocharts, who is the head of digital media at VPRO, which is one of the Netherlands' many public broadcasters. Significant for us today, he's also the chair of the Public Spaces Coalition. It's a remarkable project that's hosted at publicspaces.net. We're going to talk about this very particularly Dutch approach to thinking about reimagining the internet. Geert Jan, welcome. It's so good to have you here.
Thanks very much for having me, Ethan. It's an honor.
Well, I actually want to start by talking a little bit about your day job outside of the Public Spaces Coalition. What is VPRO? And even more broadly than that, how does public media in the Netherlands differ from public media we might understand, like NPR in the US or the BBC in the UK?
Well, traditionally, and by that I mean for the last 90 years or so, public media in the Netherlands have been organized according to originally religious denominations, right? And later on, there were some political affiliations involved as well. So we had this group of broadcasters that were organized along Protestant beliefs or Catholic beliefs or later on liberal or social democratic beliefs.
Secular humanists as well, right? I mean, that's considered a religion in the Netherlands.
In a sense, yes, absolutely. And it's interesting. Originally, VPRO, the letters actually stand for something called liberal Protestantism. There's no really equivalent British translation, I believe, but it was a group of free-thinking Protestant vicars and people in church that actually believed, okay, what the Bible teaches us is really to be as open-minded toward life and other people as we possibly can. Having, you know, that as a basis of religious thinking influences also the way you think about life and politics and so on. Now, I think it was in the 60s or 70s or so that we as VPRO did away with this Protestant background. Mm-hmm. But what's been left in our DNA, you could say, is this this free-minded, free-willing thinking about life and the many opportunities that it gives us to shine, to design, to educate, to do research, to be curious, to really look at the world with as open an eye and open a mind as possible, and to investigate.
But even within a fairly small nation, the Netherlands has not just one public broadcaster, as many European countries do. It has eight public broadcasters with different positions, different attitudes. For me, it's just such a great exemplar of a different way of sort of handling this question of what public spaces should look like. How has that, you know, sort of led to this idea of public spaces? What is the Public Spaces Coalition? What's the relationship between these public broadcasters and other cultural institutions and this coalition?
Yeah, I think in order to really understand that, I need to mention perhaps one more thing in relation to what we just talked about, which is that these broadcasters, eight of them, are not only subsidized by taxpayers' money, but they are also syndicates. They are also unions, if you will. People can become member. Right. Mm. And so VPRO is a middle-sized broadcaster in terms of membership, which means in the Netherlands we've got about 350,000 paying members. Mm-hmm. These paying members are people that feel some kind of affiliation to our programming and to our way of thinking. So that gives us a very firm basis in society. And that goes for most of the other broadcasters as well. So when we talk about the kind of programming that we need to do or the kind of problems that we need to tackle, we are very firmly rooted in these discussions that we have mm-hmm. within our own memberships. And those members are not just members of VPRO. They also belong to cultural institutions. They go to museums. They read sure. papers and so on. So through those memberships, we are able to extend like a broad network to other organizations that have like-minded views as ours. Which meant that it was a fairly small step for me to envision, okay, if we need to think or rethink or reimagine the internet as a space where the public domain really deserves a place of its own and needs to be strengthened, it was obviously immediately that there was not something that VPRO could do on its own, but that we needed to put in our network and build this coalition, because this is way too big a job to take up on our own.
Right. So even with 350,000 members, even with some state support, it's sort of a blend between the American model, in which essentially our public media are our membership organizations, and something closer to the British model, where there is a tax and sort of providing a steady revenue stream, that there's something closer to a hybrid in the Netherlands context. But you were sort of realizing that even given that sort of level of support, even given a lot of people sort of signing off on common values, the ambitions of this coalition were big enough that it couldn't just be the broadcasters. It actually had to be sort of cultural institutions as a whole. Who are the members of the Public Spaces Coalition?
Currently, it's mainly based in the cultural sector, which means that there are a number of festivals, cultural festivals, film festivals, music festivals, and so on, a design festival. There's also institutions for cultural heritage. So the Royal Dutch Library is a member. Wikimedia Netherlands is a member. Some institutions that deal with even with healthcare are members at the moment. But our focus is on cultural institutions. And I think that one of the main goals of public spaces is actually a marketing goal. And it helps that through this coalition, we are able to reach about 90% of the entire Dutch population of 17 million, right? Because we are so broadly organized, and because there are a number of public broadcasters part of it, but also all the large-scale organizations, lots of public libraries are member, we reach this amount of people. So our potential impact is fairly large.
So museums, cultural festivals, libraries, public broadcasters, sort of, anyone who's touched by sort of the life of the mind or the life of the arts in Dutch society probably has some connection to this. What is Public Spaces seeking to do? So you've talked very broadly about this sort of idea of reimagining the internet. What does that mean from your perspective?
Well, in the basis, I think the Public Spaces Coalition is bound by a common dilemma, if you will. And that dilemma is that most of our members, they have this kind of, ID, or they have programming that's very, fairly critical of the way in which we handle our digital businesses these days, right? I mean, we've become so dependent upon platforms that are not driven by public value, but by commercial value, that's fairly contrary to what we purport to be or to tell our audiences. I mean, we're critical in some of our programming of Facebook and Google and YouTube and Instagram and all those other big platforms. And at the same time, we're more or less forced to use them because we also have a legal obligation to reach as large an audience as we can. And we can't do that without them. So that's in the basis a very, it's a pickle that we found ourselves in. And we figured, okay, isn't it obvious that we really need to think about ways in which we can use public infrastructure, public digital infrastructure, to deliver the same kind of functionality that at the present is being given to us or serviced to us by Google and Facebook and the likes. right? I mean, why is it that for such basic utilities, online utilities, such as cloud-based collaboration or cooperation, or discovery and search, or even email, or watching a video, we need to pay with our data. This is, you know, if you look at equivalence in the physical world, it would mean like, you know, going to a public square, but only getting access if I'm going to show my passport to some gatekeeper. And this gatekeeper then, you know, jotting down all my details and selling them to the highest bidder, which is ridiculous. And we feel in the end, you know, public physical infrastructure is organized in a certain way, and we should seek equivalence in the digital infrastructure. So that's in the basis what we're trying to further.
And this has real implications for your work personally, right? Because you're the head of digital for VPRO. You have this challenge of how do you deliver the content that the network is producing? And you're obligated to sort of reach the broad audience. The broad audience is using YouTube, they're using Facebook, they're using sort of all of these different tools that you and I think would both acknowledge have business models that we find deeply problematic, have privacy practices that we find deeply problematic. But it's an incredibly heavy lift to sort of think about, you know, how do we create a parallel media ecosystem for the Dutch public? How is public spaces sort of taking on just the monumentality of that task, right? It makes perfect sense. If we're going to criticize surveillance capitalism, if we're going to build programming sort of criticizing this framework that we're working within, how do we then, you know, get and sort of create the different ecosystem? What has this meant in sort of practical terms as far as building this sort of alternative infrastructure?
Well, obviously, you're right. It's a big job, and we figure, well, it took us about 25 years to break the internet, and it's going to take perhaps as long to fix it again. I hope not, but we should take that into account. Having said that, I think we've got a pretty clear-cut road ahead of us. And it starts by inventorying the kind of tools and instruments that we are currently using as public organizations. So we've done this exercise for ourselves and it at VPRO. And what we've seen is that we use about 25 different, you know, digital instruments in all our digital environments and apps and so on. So talking about, tools to send out newsletters, to do analysis of our visitors, our content management systems, and so on. Next up is to kind of score all these instruments, those 25 plus instruments, on the five core public spaces values, right? Five core values that we feel are intrinsic to any sane public digital environment. So you're able to score, for instance, this newsletter tool on those five different values. And you see, okay, it scores, let's say, 60%. And then you go out in the world and you look for alternatives that have a higher score on those five values. And there are plenty of those. Because if one thing, I mean, the internet obviously is also a very rich source of open source development, highly intelligent and creative people coming up with all kinds of solutions. And it appears that for most of the functionalities that are intrinsic and very essential to our digital lives and functioning, there are tools available that do provide, you know, the same kind of functionality without selling our souls and our data to Google and Facebook. What very often is necessary is some kind of, you know, design or user interface, research phase that really would make these instruments as user-friendly as the ones that are being provided by the big commercial providers at the moment. But in the basis, there is a number of instruments and alternatives available. So that's the next step. setting up a kind of, you know, replacement investment scheduling that will tell you over the next 5 years, that's the kind of the life cycle, the average life cycle of any digital instrument. Over the next 5 years, we're going to replace one by one these big instruments by the ones that we feel score a lot better on these public spaces values. And that's, you know, a program that we share with the world. We share our templating for the scoring. We want all organizations and at least the coalition members of public spaces to do the same kind of exercise. So we learn from each other. We do the mapping exercise together. So we do our exploration of alternatives together. And in that sense, you know, piece by piece, we are able to replace the functionalities such as authentication or video sharing or whatever by the alternatives that are, you know, much more fit to work in a really public environment.
So
I'm not sure. Do I make sense at all?
It makes tremendous sense. In fact, it makes so much sense that I almost can't believe that every public broadcaster isn't just adopting this and simply going through this, right? I mean, this feels like just a very straightforward roadmap for this. It feels like something that, you know, the BBC could pick up, NPR could pick up, but also, you know, an art museum could pick up. The challenge obviously gets to actually sort of replacing what you have with different tools. Give me a sense, for instance, out of those 25 tools, what are the ones that have sort of come up as the most pressing, that are you know, extremely contrary to values and need to be changed?
I think in our case it would be the tracking tools.
Yeah.
Right. The tools that you employ on your website, in your apps, to kind of track what people are doing, how our audiences are behaving, what they are liking, what they're not liking, where they spent more time on, what they spent less time on. At the moment, at VPRO, I'm ashamed to say, we still use Google Analytics to a large extent, right? And Google Analytics is flexible in the sense that it allows you to configure more or less the kind of or the amount of data that you share. So we've configured it in such a way that we share as little data as possible with Google. We anonymize IP addresses and so on. It's all possible within that suite. But still, it's controversial, it's difficult, and we'd rather use something else.
Yeah.
At the same time, it's hard to find something really as good and as comprehensive as the Google Suite.
Here, John, talk to me a little bit about what are the public spaces values, how did the coalition come to them? Because it's very clear that, you know, that's essentially what you're testing all of these things against. You're testing against this question of what are our collective values and how do we sort of make decisions from there? What are those core values and what was the discussion that led you there?
Actually, you know, the setting out of the core values, accountability, transparency, openness, sovereignty, being autonomous, user-centricness, that wasn't so difficult. I mean, we got there in like less than a day, I suppose, mm-hmm. or even less than half a day. What's difficult is how you turn all these abstract concepts into something that we can actually work with, right? I mean, that took us 2 years. It's really, I mean, look at you know, there have been a number of manifests over the last couple of years that all kind of like are based on the same values and the same premises. Look at even, you know, the Declaration of Human Rights, all the same kind of values. In terms of our remit as public organizations, we also obviously refer to our own statutes, right? That also confer being autonomous, which means being independent from any kind of commercial or political or ideological influence, and being able to come to decisions and conclusions on your own, on the merits of, you know, your points of view, being editorially independent and so on. Being transparent actually means being open to users in the sense of showing them what your processes look like. Be transparent about your motives and about what you're there for in the world, what you're trying to achieve. Being open means allowing outside influences to come in and be open to co-creation and to work as much together with other like-minded organizations as possible. Also, embracing open source. Because also that obviously involves some kind of transparency, right? Especially if we are now coming into a new phase of thinking about, for instance, the use of AI in media production and consumption. The transparency of the algorithms that you're using is paramount. It's so important that you give people some insight in how recommender systems are being built and on the basis of what kinds of prejudices perhaps you are presenting them.
Do you feel like your users are embracing the same values, right? So just to give an example on this, I would think that one of the big challenges on this is if you move away from a highly surveillant but also highly popular platform like YouTube onto, you know, some sort of video hosting, whether you're doing your own or whether you're finding a platform that is more in line with values than YouTube, you know, do the users come with you? There's certain changes that are fairly easy to make, and you can make your decision around them. If you change your content management system, it probably doesn't have much impact on the user. But when you get into the actual delivery of your content, that has real implications for the users. Are the users on board with this as well, or is that one of the harder shifts to sort of make within this?
I think that's, you know, I briefly mentioned it before, but I think that's where the marketing aspect of our coalition comes into play. The fact that we have such a tremendous reach in the Dutch population is, I think, an important plays an important part in that. I'll give you an example. Right now, at VPRO, we are doing a project. We call it Monthly Union. It's a very rough English translation, but it's actually trying to connect women that are at the same moment in their monthly cycle, right? Mm-hmm. And we're making media around that and connecting women that are at the same moment in their monthly cycle and engaging in conversations and trying to build some kind of community around that. A couple of years ago, we probably have used WhatsApp to set up WhatsApp groups and so on. Now we're doing it all in Telegram. Mm. So moving away from WhatsApp and perhaps Telegram isn't even the best choice. We could also obviously.
I was going to say, I actually spent yesterday in a conversation with some scholars at Yale about the difficulties that Telegram is having with governance. But that actually just points to the challenges of all of this. But yeah, so you had to help people shift to a platform they might not have known as well.
Absolutely, that's the key point, and I think what we're seeing is that it's actually working, people, I mean, there has been a shift, I think, over the last couple of months at least, due to some changes in policy that have been a bit controversial from WhatsApp to other platforms, so that's helping us. But I think in general, once, you know, obviously, especially from the point of view of public broadcasters, we are content driven. And if the content is compelling enough, you get people to new platforms. That's what I firmly believe. I mean, I think Twitter actually got big because of Britain's Got Talent or some kind of show like that, at least in the UK and in Europe. Because the BBC was promoting, you know, people voting for their contestants on Twitter. So obviously that's more over 10 years ago. So times have changed, but still it points to the power of, you know, public broadcasters and compelling content in order to get people to move away. It's going to be a gradual process. It's not something that we're going to do overnight. Public spaces is not only about adopting, you know, alternatives to, you know, present solutions, commercial solutions, We're also about working together to tackle new problems. For instance, right now we're working within our coalition at a concept called proof of provenance. And proof of provenance actually, its aim is to provide people with a kind of certificate that any type of content that they encounter online is certifiably from a certain source. And they can always retrace the entire distribution chain from its origin to the present location. In whose hands has this content been? What has been done to it? And how are we going to evaluate the originators, but also the editors of the content that I'm looking at right now?
This sounds a little bit like non-fungible tokens. Please tell me that you're not moving all of Dutch public broadcasting onto the blockchain.
No, we're not. Definitely not. No. No, I mean, apart from the philosophical issues related to that, I'd also have a problem with the environmental issues,
yes,
with
indeed.
Governance and so on. Yeah. No, there has nothing to do with that. I think in technical terms, we are looking much more at proven technologies such as certificates that are being issued by, for instance, what's that provider called? That provides you with these certificates that you have to ensure credentials on the website,
right,
HTTPS
right.
and so on.
Right, server certificates, HTTPS
yeah.
certificates, the various different certificate issuing agencies. In this case, that same sort of system, which basically operates in the background for your browser and says, yes, I'm accessing publicspaces.net, and I see that there's a signed HTTPS certificate from one of those trusted certificate bodies that means that I believe that this is who I'm talking to and that my information is not being intercepted. So this might be the sort of thing where you could click on a news story and get that provenance chain of who edited it, who wrote it, where it originated?
Yeah, absolutely. While at the same time, and I think that's very important to us, maintaining some of the key elements of internet publishing. For instance, anonymity. I don't need necessarily, know who the originator is. I just need to know that it is a trusted source, right? So this is broadly applicable. For instance, if I'm running a website, which is, aiming to help anorectic girls. And, it should be mainly available for girls between 15 and 20. I don't want to know who these girls are, but I do need to know it's only accessible to them. So
right.
A certificate could be issued by a health provider, right? Stating that this girl actually is in such a position and she should be allowed access to this forum. Solutions like that, we're looking at that very closely because we feel it's an important part of functionality that people have come to rely upon. They shouldn't be, they shouldn't have to go to a Facebook group to talk about deeply personal problems like that.
One of the things that's most exciting to me is this possibility that there might be a European counterweight to these models that have been emerging, right? There's the US model of highly surveillant but also highly competitive apps. And, apps tend to do one thing and then they're sort of acquired and built either into the Facebook or the Google empire. The other model seems to be the Chinese model, where every app seems to do everything, right? You build an app to be sort of an integrated ecosystem that does everything from, make payments to deliver pizza to deliver you news. There's occasional outliers in that ecosystem, like Telegram, which is built by a pair of exiled Russians who might be in Dubai and might not be. But for the most part, it feels like this sort of US-China battle. It feels like you might have sort of a European pole within this, that could actually end up being sort of a counterweight to that. Is that the ambition of the conference, which by the way, I'm speaking at tomorrow? I'm looking forward to it. This episode will go up a little bit after it happens, but I'm sure there'll be a good record for it.
I think it's important to mention also that at the end of the conference tomorrow, we're going to have elections in the Netherlands next week, actually. And there is an agreement by a lot of our parties that the next cabinet would need to engage much more in digital policymaking. And there is an agreement what that policymaking should be bound by, and the kind of, you know, broad agreements that any policy should be based upon. And we're very, you know, optimistic that this actually will get a place in next cabinet's policy making. Finally, I think it's also important to mention, talking about Europe, that what we're trying to do fits in a European tradition, because we've got a history of serving public utilities in a way by publicly funded organizations, but that are still operating autonomously from political influence. That's under some pressure, especially in countries like Poland and Hungary and so on. But in large parts of Europe, especially in Western and Southern Europe, it's still very much, you know, the model that we live by, and that shields us from political whims and you know, the kind of partisan politics that plagues much of American policymaking nowadays. Gives us this autonomy while also ensuring this kind of funding that we need.
Yeah, it is this moment where the European commitment to public goods, the European commitment to public service that is not the voice of the government but might actually be a set of enormously diverse voices, as you're getting in Dutch public broadcasting, but also this notion of cooperation and saying, you know, we don't want the world to work this way. We want it to work differently. And so now let's make a plan and let's actually work towards it. I find public spaces just one of the most enormously inspiring projects out there. I would love for it to be much better known in the US and sort of around the world. And let's hope we can have a small contribution on this. The project is at publicspaces.net. Herr John, it's just been wonderful to have you here. I just love this project since the first time you came and visited MIT and we talked about it. I've been hugely excited about it, and I wish you the best of luck with the conference.
Thank you very much. And you forget to mention that you are actually yourself one of the inspirers of a Public Spaces project, because it was an interview with you in which you called for innovative European broadcasters to come up and stand up and try to do something about this dominance of Google and Facebook that actually inspired me to write the very first version of our manifesto.
That is incredible to hear, and I'm not sure the credit's really due to me, but I will take it. And thank you so much for being with us, and this is just so exciting, and I hope you get inquiries all over the world coming out of the conference, and I'm going to let you go do the opening. I look forward to being with you at it tomorrow, and thank you for being with us on Reimagining the Internet.
Thanks very much, Ethan. Bye-bye.